Pleased to be joined now by NBC Sports NFL insider Peter King, who joins us here now, as you know, weekly author of Football Morning in America and a Pro Football Hall of Fame selector as well. Peter, good to have you on again. How you doing a month into the season here?
Oh, it's been fun so far, Chris. Steve, it's every year takes on a life of its own, obviously, but you know, I never thought that we would be sort of living in a world with, you know, things like the Raiders being 1-3 and the Giants being 3-1. I never thought we would have the two New York area teams with a better overall record than the two LA teams. So, yeah, it's been a weird start to the year, but then again, it always is.
How surprised were you, because there's only one undefeated team left, and it's Philly. How surprised are you that that's the case?
I mean, it's just a weird year for that, Steve, because I had it on my column the other day, 2 years ago, entering October, there were seven undefeated teams. Now there's only one. And it's just a little bit of a fluky thing. And the way the NFL really is concentrated on doing it more and more and more in recent years is they like the lesser lights to play each other early so that, you know, so that, for instance, the Giants are 3-1. Does anybody think the Giants are going to win 3 out of 4 games every month this season? I don't, you know. And, you know, does anybody think that, you know, the Rams and the 49ers are 2-2 caliber teams? I mean, who knows? Maybe the Rams are. But I think that one of the things the NFL has done is you've seen a lot of great matchups so far, you know, and you just look to this last weekend, you know, you got Kansas City and Tampa in a Super Bowl rematch. You got the Bills and the Ravens, you know, two premier teams playing. So they try to make it so that as many teams as possible are really competitive throughout the year. And so therefore, you know, a team like the Giants, a team like the Jets, you know, they want them involved as long as they can.
Let's talk about one of the storylines in your most recent column. It dealt with the Bills and Jordan Poyer's 2-interception performance against the Ravens, which was critical in the comeback effort from 17 points down. It's no secret that Poyer, in the offseason, lobbied for more money in his contract, if not an extension, as he's entering the last year of his deal. His play on the field is certainly strengthening his case. But maybe just comment number one on the performance and where you think it might go, knowing the Bills are tight against the cap.
Here's how I sort of look at this. I don't think the Bills have lost a player they truly wanted to keep. You know, they've lost some good players since Brandon Bean has been the general manager. And every team does. But I don't think they've lost a player that they would consider, I don't know, maybe it's an overstatement to say Jordan Poyer is a cornerstone player, but that's how I think of him with the Buffalo Bills. And honestly, I just don't think they're going to lose him. The other thing that I think about this situation is that when you look at how the Bills kind of have built their team, you know, they get and they keep guys who they feel are really important parts of the fabric of this team. And my feeling is that Poyer is one of those guys. He's got an agent in Drew Rosenhaus who very much is a deal maker and not a bomb thrower. So I think something will get done at some point. I have no inside information whatsoever on it, but I think I think he's going to get done.
One of the other things about this as this season progresses that happened in the offseason was Brian Daboll, the offensive coordinator, going from the Bills over to the New York. And you there, you know, I know you spend a lot of time in New York City, and surprising, and Bills fans have kind of a passing interest now in the Giants because of Brian Daboll and the good stuff he did here. And I don't, it's hard to imagine him getting off to a more favorable start for what has been a really tough situation the past handful of years.
Look, the Giants were in a terrible situation when Joe Shane got the GM job. I did not know Joe Shane from Adam when he took this job. But in the time I've spent with him, I'll tell you a quick little Joe Shane story that I think says a lot about him. When I was putting together my mock draft before the draft, I had a long conversation with him on Saturday. My column comes out on Monday. The first round of the draft is Thursday. So, you know, I called him and I was trying to squeeze out some information, and he's not giving up anything. Nobody does, really. But I'm talking to him a little bit about Kayvon Thibodeau. And one of the reasons I kind of appreciate Joe Shane and sort of how honorable he is that I forget, at some point I told him who I was probably going to give the Giants in the draft. And I said to him, you know, I'm really curious about you and Kayvon Thibodeau. For some reason, it just makes sense, blah, blah, blah. And he said, well, you know, I don't know. We don't know. We truly don't know. But I spent about a half hour with him on the phone this weekend, and because I really wanted to get to the bottom of a few things. I wanted to really invest my time and find out about some things for myself and not just believe what I might have heard or what somebody else might have told me. And he goes, it was really valuable. And if I had half a brain in my head, I would have said, okay, put Kayvon Thibodeau down for the Giants, either with the fifth pick or the seventh pick. But I don't have half a brain in my head. I only have a quarter of one. So that wasn't smart enough to know that Joe Shane was really trying to send me signals and trying to help me in my draft. But I appreciate the fact that this guy, he's a worker bee. He's going to go down every rabbit hole to try to find out the information. There's one other thing about the Giants and about those two guys who I think were trained very well, you know, in the Bills system under Brandon Bean and Sean McDermott. I mean, very well. And that is that, listen, you've got to be realistic about what you have, okay? And the Giants at the start of the season, they didn't want to cut James Bradbury. He's a top 15 NFL corner. They didn't want to do that. But Joe Shane knew that he had to do it because he's got to have a little bit of cap flexibility. He cuts him. He goes to the Eagles. He made a huge play in a win for the Eagles the other day, an interception of Trevor Lawrence at the goal line. And so basically, because Dave Gettleman did a crappy job with the salary cap with the Giants, and it falls on Joe Shane and Brian Daboll to try to fix it, they lose a really good player. But anyway, my point is, you don't hear Joe Shane and Brian Daboll crying about that, about being saddled with a crummy, incredibly overpaid wide receiver in Kenny Golladay. They just cope with it. And I think the players on this team really kind of appreciate Daboll because he's just a guy. You know, he's a mensch from, you know, who's got a lot of roots in Western New York. And I think that they have done all the right things so far. They're not making the playoffs. They're not turning it around in 1 year. But this is the first time, if you follow the Giants, you think that maybe they got a chance with these two guys.
Let's look at the Bills division. And with what's happened with the Dolphins organization this past week, it hasn't put them in a favorable light, and this isn't the first time in recent history they haven't been in a favorable light. They've had a rough couple of years here making headlines for all the wrong reasons. This is a pretty bad one, though, in light of all the efforts that the league has made for player safety and greater player safety, I should say. What happened last week, some people believe, set the concussion protocol back a decade. Where do you come down on the severity of this? It's clearly a step back, Peter. How would you quantify it?
Well, Chris, I think the worst part of this is, you know, I went on Twitter the other day as I was getting ready to write my column, and I asked people, especially parents of youth football players, to tell me what this meant. And I had a guy who wrote to me from Massachusetts who said, you know, I got a son who's 9 years old. I really want him to play. And we're watching the game, and we, you know, we saw what happened to Tagovailoa on Sunday against Buffalo. And then nothing happened. He came back in the game. And on Thursday, he takes another big hit, and now he's out. He gets sent off on a stretcher. And we're in the middle of that game watching it. My wife turns to me and says, and that is why Charlie will never play football. You can't dismiss or not think a lot about what this incident has done to people who are parents who are on the fence about football anyway. And look, there are going to be people in the state of Florida, because it's a football mad youth football state, who are not going to be dissuaded from having their kids play football. It's going to be people in Texas and in California and a lot of football hotbed states, Georgia, Louisiana. But there might be some people in Orchard Park and Hamburg and all the little hamlets in Western New York where they have had a good football tradition, and all the little hamlets around the country who've had good football tradition. But you're hearing more and more stories now about people who, you know, schools and youth groups who are dropping football, participation numbers are down. If you don't think the NFL's not worried about that, I can tell you they are worried about that. And that is, and look, it's far more worrying for the players than it is for people in the future. And I understand that, but I'm saying another factor that we should consider is that the NFL is concerned about the future as well.
And one of the, you know, obvious questions is what happens going forward. How do you, and certainly if there are changes made and they seem to work, this will be in the rearview mirror, but how soon do you think, you know, tangible changes will happen in the NFL? And you know, this is too, as soon as they change those protocols, they're going to trumpet it like, you know, like the results of a presidential election.
Look, Steve, I think it's going to happen this week. I don't think they're going to start playing Thursday night without something happening to the concussion protocol. My guess is that what Mike Florio reported on Football Night Sunday is exactly what's going to happen. And what he said was the gross motor instability term, for people who don't know, there's a clause in the concussion protocol that says if a player demonstrates gross motor instability on the field during the game, then that player has got to be taken off and put through concussion protocol. And the tests, you know, that are going to be given to a player to see if he can continue to play. Now, it turns out that Tua Tagovailoa passed those tests at halftime of that game and went back to play. Tua said, it's my back, it's not my head. I mean, I don't know. I've covered the NFL for this is my 39th year. And I've heard a lot of excuses from players who don't want to go out of the game and who won't admit that their head hurts. And I'm not saying that that's the case with Tua, but this reminds me of a lot of guys who say, oh, it's not my head, it's my neck, it's my back, it's my shoulder. In my opinion, what Florio reported is what absolutely should happen. If you demonstrate gross motor instability, have to be helped off the field, you're woozy, you're punch drunk, your day should be over, period. And I hope the NFL and the NFLPA come to that conclusion this week.
How much do you throw in there as well that the Dolphins, and they knew this going in, and they kind of probably have conversations about it like every team does, the fact that, you know, it takes 5 days, five full days, to get through the concussion protocols, even if, you know, if you're in the protocol, it takes 5 days because you got to go step by step by step, and there are 24-hour waiting periods between each step. You know, you have to go light aerobic work, then football-specific stuff that's light, and then a little more intense, and then a full practice. And between each of those steps is 24 hours where you come back in the next day
test baseline.
And also, if you don't have headaches or any further symptoms. How much of the fact, and this has been a big topic around, that the Dolphins were staring at a Thursday night game knowing that if anybody goes into concussion protocols on a Sunday, they can't make it back at all and under any circumstances for the Thursday night game. What kind of wrinkle, you know, degree of difficulty does that throw into it? And does that, and that seems to light a fire under teams like, hey, don't put him in the protocols.
Well, you know, that's something that if there was any motivation because of that to not put him in the protocol, people should lose their jobs. But here's the issue, Steve. On Sunday, in the game against Buffalo, apparently the unaffiliated neurotrauma consultant and the Dolphins team physician both said that he does not have a concussion and that he doesn't have evidence of a concussion. He passed the test just fine, and he's good, and we're going to let him go back in the game. So I understand everybody is up in arms about this, but if a guy does not get put in the concussion protocol after the game, if doctors and an unaffiliated team, you know, a neurologist who's unaffiliated with the team, both agree that he does not have a concussion and his wooziness did not stem from head trauma, if that's what they think, it's impossible to be critical of Mike McDaniel for keeping him out of the game.
Yeah.
The onus falls on the medical people.
Right, right.
And it's easy on Thursday to say, what is Mike McDaniel doing playing him? Anybody would have played him.
Right.
So that is the problem here. The problem is if somebody demonstrates the gross motor instability absolutely unequivocally, he's done for the day, no matter whether he shows concussion symptoms or not. You've got to take him off the field. So I think that's where it all has to start.
Yeah. The Bills will be – they're tied for number one in the league in total defense, Peter. Heck of a way for Kenny Pickett to make his first NFL start on the road. And Steve was actually looking at the Steelers' schedule for the next month. It is a rough road for Kenny Pickett to traverse here in the next 4 weeks.
He's got the toughest schedule in football over the next five games.
So what do you make of it, and what do you foresee?
I think he's going to get swamped on Sunday. I think it's not going to be pretty. But I also think to myself, if I were Mike Tomlin, would I be playing Mitchell Trubisky again? No. I mean, I think everybody thought that Mitchell Trubisky spending 1 year with Brian Daboll and Ken Dorsey and sitting in the room with Josh Allen every day was going to be, you know, like a trip to some incredible day spa where all of a sudden you run a magic wand and you're healthy and you're cured of all ills.
Right.
And Mitchell Trubisky is Mitchell Trubisky. You know, I don't mean to be cruel, but he had a lot of chances to prove himself in Chicago. You can blame Matt Nagy, you can blame this, blame that, whatever. Fact is, he very rarely played well with any consistency in Chicago. He's showing the same thing in Pittsburgh. So I'd give Pickett a shot right now, too. I think the key for Kenny Pickett is for the Steelers to be able to run the ball even slightly better which is going to be hard, but they need to run the ball a little bit better. So it's not always going to be second and eight, second and nine. That to me is the key. But look, Kenny Pickett, I think, started 47 games, if I'm not mistaken, in, you know, at the University of Pittsburgh. That's not North Dakota State. You know, he had some games there. So I don't think you should be, if you're a Steeler fan, despondent about Kenny Pickett. I think he'll be okay. He just needs a chance.
Yeah, I would agree with you. No question. Pittsburgh, Mike Tomlin, I think, is a great head coach to do this. And even if Kenny Pickett was ready to play it on opening day, I think it was probably the right move to let him sit for a month and watch Mitch Trubisky and learn what he can. And I'll say this too, Pete. I was under the impression as well. I thought being with the Bills for a year would help Mitch Trubisky, particularly listening to Josh Allen and what he thought and what he saw and how he played. Certainly Mitch Trubisky doesn't have to be Josh Allen, but at least he would learn what it looks like to be in that environment. Yeah. I was disappointed in the way Mitchell Trubisky has played thus far this year. I thought he would, that year in Buffalo would help him at least somewhat. And maybe it did. I don't know. But you're right. The results are what they are.
Don't you have to think that, you know, Trubisky has been so mentally battered by everybody just continually pointing out that, you know, can you believe this guy was drafted ahead of, you know, Deshaun Watson and Patrick Mahomes? You know, how crazy is that? I think it's hard to mentally just put that to the side. You know, looking at the incredible success, particularly Patrick Mahomes has a very good chance to be a top 10 quarterback in history. And, you know, somehow, some way, all these teams, including the Bears, needing a quarterback in the long-term future, passed on Patrick Mahomes, you know, to take Mitchell Trubisky. So it's a pretty hard pill for him to swallow. I feel bad for him. But, you know, I think the one other thing to say about this game this week is that it's easy to look at this game and say, if you're the Bills, whew, boy, after facing two intenso games in a row, it looks like we might have a little bit of a breather. Mike Tomlin, my history with Mike Tomlin is that it's almost like with Belichick. Just when you think it's over and they can just mail it in the rest of the year, you watch. Mike Tomlin's going to come to Buffalo or maybe play Tampa sometime in the next couple of weeks. In one of those games, Pittsburgh's going to be ahead with 8 minutes to go. Somehow, some way. I don't know why. I don't know how. And I don't think it'll be this week. But at some point, you know, Tomlin's going to have this team ready to go and playing well. I think this will probably be a closer game than anybody thinks. When Tomlin is backed up against the wall, he usually figures out a way to make it competitive.
Last one for me, Pete, and this is kind of off topic. It's about what you were saying earlier in that answer. You're right. Mitch Trubisky is up against it after being picked so high in the draft. My question, and we'll never know the answer, I'd love your opinion, would Pat Mahomes be the player he is today if Chicago takes him third overall?
Yes, yes, yes. 1,000 times yes. They may not be – he may not be as good or as impactful because Andy Reid is going to go down as one of the best coaches in modern football. And who knows what would have happened to Matt Nagy. But just remember, Matt Nagy was Patrick Mahomes' first, you know, day-to-day coordinator, shoulder to cry on, guy to help, teacher, everything in Kansas City when he was drafted. So that was a good relationship. And Matt Nagy is really smart, I think. Look, they haven't had a quarterback other than a pretty good one in Jim McMahon. But, I mean, they really haven't had a great quarterback since Sid Luckman. And, honestly, you know, the odds are against you in Chicago because of the weather, because of the history, all that stuff. I think Mahomes would have laughed at that had he gone to Chicago or quite honestly, had he gone to many places. Patrick Mahomes is simply, an unstoppable force, I think, in football. It helps that he goes to Kansas City and played for Andy Reid, but I think he would have been good anywhere.
Peter, thanks very much for the time. We appreciate it as always. We'll catch up with you down the line.
Thanks, Pete.
Hey, thanks a lot, guys. Great seeing you. Bye, Steve.